You know who this is? John Lennon. You remember him?
Yes.
You're probably all too young, so many of you. The Beatles, right? John Lennon was an avowed atheist. Now, I have read some things that people have said about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the historical Jesus. But he takes the cake. Absolutely blasphemous the way he made a commentary on Jesus. He was an atheist. He did actually went on, in 1980, he went on a sailing trip with a crew from to Bermuda, what was the location that he left? I can't remember that. But they were out in the open ocean and they were there for quite some time. And then a storm broke loose, a storm that was very, very, very bad. And it really wore out the crew, and they were all seasick and exhausted. John Lennon wasn't, he reckons, because his overcoming the addiction of heroin rendered him, what shall I say, immune to seasickness. He had to take the steering wheel, that's not at the moment when it was a disaster. He found that an extraordinary experience. They could have perished, but they didn't. And he realized how fragile life really is. And when he got back, he listened to some music there of Bob Marley and the Wailers. I don't know whether you know them. And the theme was Hallelujah Time. And he heard this statement, living on borrowed time. And this is what he said. He said, come to think of it, it is what we are all doing. But even though most of us don't like to face it, I wonder if he did. That very year, some months later, on the 8th of December, he was gunned down by a person that I don't think we ever knew the reason. Took his life, just like that. In front of his wife, in front of the apartment in New York where he lived. And that was the end of John Lennon. He certainly was living on borrowed time. But he never used it, as far as the relationship with God is concerned. And now it's over. Now it's over. Pontius Pilate was, at best, a cruel prefect. But he was the fifth one in the province of Judea. He was a procurator, which means he's a military ruler. And he served all his life under Tiberius Caesar. He did something that some people were talking about when they were with Jesus. So when they were with Jesus, these people, not his disciples, were saying that about some of the Galileans and something that Pilate did to them, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. You had a group of Galileans that came into the temple grounds. Now, Pilate never trusted anybody. He had some of his own soldiers dressed up like Jews and getting into the courtyard, which was really forbidden. They shouldn't, because they were non-Jews. But for some reason, and we don't really know the historical reason, Pilate had a slaughter of these Galileans. We don't even know how many there were. It's poorly recorded, but there it is. This is what happened. And what the Jews were so upset about is not just the killing of the Galileans, but the disrespect that Pilate instructed to be affected by his soldiers, that the blood of the victims they had slaughtered was mingled with the sacrifices. They were really, really, it inflamed the hatred immensely, immensely. And Jesus answered and said to them, they obviously wanted to know why. Not just why they were killed, but why it happened. Then this is what Jesus said. Do you suppose that these Galileans were worse sinners than all other Galileans? Well, the answer is very clear, and he gives the answer. Even though they suffered such things, he said, no, I tell you, they are not worse sinners. They're not. He's trying to get into their mindset. Their mindset is, if something bad happens to you, it's the wrath of God. Do you understand? And you know what? That is not just what they thought. That is still very much entrenched in our thinking today. That when you do something wrong, obviously you get punished, right? Remember the book of Job? His friends said, just that. They said, you must have had some secret sins that we didn't know about because you looked so good from the outside, and God raved about him. He was such a righteous man and a wonderful man and godly man. They have no idea what's happening there out in the universe, what's been agreed upon. And they think that Job must have practiced very secret sins, terrible sins, to suffer such consequences. But anyway, so if you suffered, it was because you deserved it. Get the picture a little bit? That's very important that we get that straight. Because that's not how it is. It can be, but it's not how it is. Because they suffered such things, I tell you no, Jesus said, but unless you repent, you will likewise perish. Now that word here, teshuva, that comes from the verb shuv, the middle part here, consonants, it means a returning. Shuv is really a turning around and going back. So in other words, repenting means you go back to what you know is right. Can I? Yeah? So that's basically what he's saying. Unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. You won't be necessarily slaughtered by Pilate's soldiers, but you will perish. You will perish. This is a reality. Now have a look at the next one. There was an incident at the Tower of Siloam, which is just on the south side of the East Jerusalem, still today, well, the place. Of those 18 on whom the Tower of Siloam fell. They were building a tower and it collapsed. Obviously, they didn't have a good architect. Maybe it was a builder of the Opal Towers there in Olympic Park, we don't know. But it collapsed and it killed 18 people. It killed 18 people. It killed them. And so, again, they're inviting Jesus to give a comment on this. He says, do you think that they were worse sinners than all other men who dwelt in Jerusalem? Nobody says. I tell you, he says, no. But unless you repent, you will likewise perish. Now, it may not be by a tower falling on you, but you will perish. So it's really repent or perish. In reply to the question that is, really presented here, why do these bad things happen? They must have deserved it. Why did they deserve it? He says, you repent or perish. Are you getting how Jesus is dealing with this? He doesn't have to explain God and God's decision, what God allows or does not prevent. What he's saying, you worry about your own morality. Are you with me in this one? Do you understand that? And he does it in a very intricate way. Why did it happen? Did Jesus answer the question? No, not really. Or did he? If Jesus was physically here in person and you would ask Jesus, why this, why that, would his answer be any different? Would it? What would he say? You know what? He would say, if he were to be physically standing here in front of you, he would be saying, unless you repent, you will likewise perish. You should concern yourself with you and your relationship with God. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
That is really the message. Now I want to dwell on that a little bit. What he's saying, you didn't get killed by Pilate's soldiers. The tower didn't fall on you. You are still alive. They were no more deserving of it than you. Could have happened to you, it didn't. It's the wrong question. It really, and people do this, how can a loving God equated with what happens and find its finding place in this world? The cruelty is exhausting, terrible. You watch the world news, you know what you see. Read. There are no more deserving of it than you. So how did Jesus address the issue of unfairness, if he addressed it at all? Just to illustrate what the Jews were like, and his disciples were Jews, so they had the same thing. It's about the story of a man born blind receives his sight because Jesus heals him. Now have a look at this story. Now as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind, this is in Jerusalem, from when? Okay, so he's always been blind, is that fair enough? We understand that. And his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents that he was born blind? Now I have a question for you. How can the blind man be blamed for being the cause of his blindness? Did he have opportunity to sin in the mother's womb?
No.
How stupid a question is this? No, it is. It's thick. The parents, well, why would the child suffer for the parents? Can be as a consequence, bad habits. Can you see that it is ridiculous? Okay. Now Jesus gave a straight answer. Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. Now that's interesting. He's born blind. He's going to be cured by whom? Jesus. He will receive his sight. Have a look at this. And he said to the man, the blind man, go and wash in a pool of Siloam, that is the eyes. Because Jesus spat on the ground, took the dirt from the ground, mixed it, put it on his eyes. Why did he do that? Why couldn't he go just like that? He'd done that before. He didn't have to touch him, he could speak it. He was going to cure him. The power was there from above. Why did he tell the man to go to the pool of Siloam and wash his eyes?
He wanted to save
the lake. Ah, lovely. Well, how much good would spitting and dirt of the ground on your eyes do for your eyes? Not a lot. But it was asked of him, and he did it. And he regained his sight. And can you imagine, you've never seen suddenly people. Oh, is that what they look like? That's what I look like. That's what water looks like. Trees, buildings. Can you imagine? Of course you can imagine. This was quite a thing. Now we come to the parable of the barren fig tree. I love this one. This is very good. So within the Gospel of Luke, we take it from there, in the 13th chapter. Have a look at what it says here. So the parable of the barren tree. He also spoke this parable. This is really in reply to their question, why did these bad things happen to these Galileans and this unfortunate thing happening to these people in Jerusalem when the Tower of Siloam collapsed? He also spoke this parable. A certain man, you've got to watch this very closely so you get the gist. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. Now, I'm going to share this thing straight away with you. This is a parable, so it's a comparison. From the known to the unknown. That's what parables were. From something that, they were an agricultural society. So Jesus often used anything from growing to animals to herds and all that sort of stuff. And then what he would do, he would take that and he would give a message of a spiritual nature, and the parable explained the meaning of the spiritual, which they so often didn't get. Why? Because they had preconceived ideas. When someone has preconceived ideas, the first thing you normally need to do is to undo those ideas. And then you run into obstacles because you have to prove beyond a very reasonable doubt that what they believe is not correct. And once they can open their minds, you can tell them the truth. Get it? And there's a way of doing that, lovingly, carefully, but it has to be done. Are you understanding what I'm getting at? Now, This fig tree here is Israel. If you can just put it in here. The fig tree is, Israel, this is Judah. 10 northern tribes are gone, you know, ready for over 700 years. So the fig tree, let's just call it Israel, in his vineyard. Now the certain man, as you will see, is God. Yeah? And the vineyard is where he put the fig tree. Where did he put the fig tree? Well, land of Canaan, Palestine, whatever you like to call it, Israel. This belongs to him. That's also established. And he came seeking fruit on it. You would expect that. That's what you do. That's your business. And he found none. That's not very good. So he found none. Then he said to the keeper of this vineyard. Now you're going to see in a minute who the keeper of this vineyard is. Look, for 3 years I have come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and I have found none. Just one more line. Cut it down. Why should it use up the ground? Now I'm going to put it to you that the keeper of the vineyard is Jesus Christ. Okay? These 3 years are his mission as a Messiah. This is about the time he's just given 3 years. You understand that? And God the Father looks at it, the fig tree or Israel, and he says, there's no progress. There's no fruit. There's no fruit. They're not changing. It hasn't borne any fruit. They still don't accept him. They still reject him. He's got 12 blokes walking with him, sometimes there were 70, they didn't last, they walked away, and Jesus said, you want to go too? No. Peter said, no. Where else can we go? Now it's interesting. But he answered and said to him, this is the keeper, this is Christ. He says, sir, let it alone this year also. The text doesn't say, give him another year. It says, this year. He has been in his ministry for 3 years. Part of a year counts as a full year in the Hebrew inclusive reckoning. So when he talks about another year, more time, of an unspecific duration, it could be 12 months, it could be 2 months. He's about 4 or 5 months away from crucifixion. Yeah? Does everybody follow me so far?
Yeah.
Okay. So you know what that means. Until I dig around it and fertilize, what's he doing? This is intercession, isn't it? This is mediation. This is intercession. It's not even mediation. The fig tree is not asking for anything. This is really mediation. Intercession. Pleading for Israel. He wants to give him more time. You think they got it?
No.
No, they didn't. They didn't. And if it bears fruit, well, that'll be good. But if not, well, by all means, cut it down. Cut it down. Get the picture here?
Yes.
Okay, this is good. Now, I remember John the Baptist talking about cutting a tree down. He had a very unpopular message. First, you had to repent. The other thing that he warned you about is the judgment. Even now, and they didn't like to hear that, even now the axe is laid to the root of the tree, therefore every tree, not some, every tree that does not bear good fruit, so you got to be good fruit bearing tree, that one, if you're not, is cut down and it'll be thrown in the fire. That's judgment. They didn't like it because they thought they were Abram's seed, they were saved. John says, no, you're not. He said, the axe is already right there. The judgment is that close. That's what he told them. They didn't like it. Robinson Crusoe. How many of you read the book of Robinson Crusoe? Oh, come on. How many?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Nobody.
I don't know.
I've got one. Have I? Or are you just waving? Two. Ah. Written by Daniel Defoe, it was published in 1719. Daniel Defoe was a Puritan. He was a very godly man. He wrote books, Christian living, Christian issues, hymns. Very godly, Puritan he was. He was a very godly man. And when you read Robinson Crusoe, there is a lot of God in it. And it's all about God. Now, you know the story of Robinson Crusoe. So he got on this island, and reportedly, according to the story, which was, what shall I say, mirrored on an actual occurrence of someone, but very different. Here we have 28 years of absence. And it was recently, so many years ago, a movie with Tom Hanks. Very similar. Mm-hmm. Yeah, saw that one? Yeah. Okay, 28 years away from where you were, on this island. And after 24 years, of the first 24 years, he's on his own, and then he meets a native, and he calls him on a Friday, and that's why he calls him Friday. And he saves him from some of his peers or fellow men who want to kill him, and he saves him, and they become very close, and he teaches him English. He doesn't speak English, but he teaches him English. That could take 28 years. And so he teaches him English. Then he teaches him about God, about the Bible, about Jesus Christ. And the man is just accepting everything that he says. But they have this conversation. I just wanted to share you this portion of the conversation. Friday, that's the native. If God is very, I put it here in proper English, you understand. If God is very strong, much more than the devil, why does God not kill the devil, so stop him from doing evil? The answer of Crusoe is quite brilliant, simple, but brilliant. You may as well ask why God does not kill you and me when we do wicked things. Do you now understand why Jesus is saying to them, you repent, otherwise you will perish? Because they are not more worthy of destruction or whatever than you are. Do you understand what he's really saying here?
Yes.
Get it? Okay. Because Robinson Crusoe said it so nicely. God is not the source of evil. Satan and sin are responsible, and we play ball in this. Yeah, we do. We are. Human suffering is produced from two different sources. It was addressed here, a man-made one, that's the killing of the Galileans, a natural evil one, the Tower of Siloam, is this an accident, and you can add diseases, pestilences, endemic, whatever, tidal waves, hurricanes, yeah, tsunamis. They happen. But the heart of the human problem, this is uncertainty for us. But the heart, you can be certain of this, the heart of the human problem is the human heart. This is where we struggle. Stop worrying about what might happen. The tower, Roman soldiers, well, we're not worried about those. But whatever. It is time, Jesus said, to repent. And it'd be good if you did it now, if you haven't already. Why do bad things happen to good people? Well, that's the wrong question. We always ask that. That's the wrong question. Why do good things happen to bad people like me? I was going to say like you, but I thought I'd better say like me. That's the right question. That is the right question. Here's another one. What kind of God let this happen? You know, that's all the misery in the world, all the suffering in the world. Wrong question. Wrong question. Here, what kind of God lets us live? Now, that's the right question. We are living on borrowed time. That's the thought behind it. Insurance policies. You have insurance? Oh, mate, they're coming out of your ears, don't they? And don't they charge like a wounded bull? But would you go without it? Now suppose you're overdue. You either haven't got the money or you live back in the olden days when you used to write out a check, put it in the mailbox and hope that it will get there and then they'll get the payment and your insurance policy is valid. Today you pick up a mobile phone and it, 5 seconds later, depending how clever you are, it's all done. But let's just say You can't either make it for whatever reason. So what are you looking for? You need the insurance. You need the insurance. You can't do without it, just in case. But you can't quite make the payment yet. So what do? You phone them, give some sob story, and then you get some grace from an insurance. Why? Because they're nice people? No, because they help you pay the premium later, but not 2 months later. So what happens is they give you an extension of time. Is that true? They give you an extension of time. You know, that's how God is, in a sense. For example, he does it for the wonderful reason. God's grace period of time is very different from the insurance company. However, there's a limit to his grace period. There's a limit on that time. You understand all of that too, don't you?
Yes.
Okay. And you're in it. You're in it. You're absolutely in it today. You and I, no exception here, we're all living in the God's grace period of time. That means you are on borrowed time. We're all born sinners, is that true?
Yes.
Anybody born a saint?
Yeah.
Now you're just scratching your head, aren't you?
Yeah. I said no.
No.
I said no.
Okay. We all have sinned. What is the wages of sin?
Death.
Yeah, well there you go. You sound king. There we have it. There we have it. So you and I, and all of us, are living on borrowed time. Can you agree? We are. You're in it today. There's a divine deadline. Of course, there is a divine judgment. There is. And so, here is the best advice that I can give you. You will never get any better advice than this advice. So, please be very, very attentive and retentive. When guilty, and that is, that's all of us, yeah? When, if you think you're not guilty, you're lost anyway. So, when guilty, settle your case out of court. A lot cheaper in our civil law system. Because if the court won't convict you or fine you, you have to pay legal fees. Boy, I think I'd rather have the sentence from the court. When guilty, settle your case out of court and take a plea. Make a plea or a plea bargain. Confess your guilt and you'll be amazed about the outcome. It's very good. That's the counsel I give you. Does everybody understand what I just said here?
Yes.
Okay, very good. People say, is it never too late? Some people say, oh, it's never too late. I had this lady once and she said, well, listen, I believe in forgiveness of sins. I said, so do I. She said, whatever I do wrong, mistakes I've made, it'll be forgiven. I said, you're absolutely right. If you confess your sins and you turn around and you have the right living and you have Christ in your life, yeah, for sure, you know. She said, no. She said, even if I live a whole life in a bad way, and I'm not sure whether she is, she says, if I just before I die, say, Lord, forgive me, I'm forgiven. And I said to her, no, it can be too late. I remember an incident. I was driving my car, and we were approaching a traffic light, and it happened out west, and this truck came on the opposite direction. I stopped, good boy that I am, don't know where I got the 13 points from, and I stopped for the red light, and this truck did not on the opposite side, and of course, obviously, it was simultaneous. And he had to avoid a car that was already making its inroad from the right-hand turn from my side. And I still see the face of the driver,
of the car,
who wasn't set out to kill me, truck passed by and the space between his car and my car, we could say he should have scraped the paint of my car. He just didn't. But the distance between his truck, 10-ton truck, and me, and I wouldn't be standing here had he been completely, of course, would be no more than the thickness of a stripe of butter on a boarding house piece of toast. That's how close it would be. That is how close it would be. And I thought to myself, I should really pray, maybe. What are you going to say in 3 seconds? Do you really believe that you can then... No, the lady was wrong. The lady was wrong. Anyway. But God is gracious. I love this from Exodus. It's fantastic. Or Numbers, I'm sorry. The Lord is slow to anger, abundant in loving kindness, forgiving iniquity and transgression, but he will by no means what? He can't. Now we're all guilty, but if we're forgiven, then we're not. It's like that. That is true. That part is true. Absolutely true. He is merciful, and let me put it to you, that sinners are still alive and are still living is because of that mercy. He gives them an extension of time. He gives them grace. Grace is the borrowed, probably the borrowed time that he extends to you. Do you understand? It's a good thought. It's a sobering thought, isn't it? Here we are alive, and we've got to be realizing this. Now there's another one. And I just want to incorporate this one, the other tree. There's a cursed fig tree. So one of them was unfruitful and never really bore fruit. And here we have a cursed fig tree. We are now days away from that fateful Friday when he was crucified. Now have a look. For the next day, that is Tuesday, the Tuesday before the Friday. When they had come out from Bethany, Bethany was less than 2 k's walking around the Mount of Olives. You can walk to Jerusalem. It's that close. That's where Mary lived and Lazarus and then, yeah. Okay. When they had come from Bethany, he was hungry. This is in the morning. And seeing afar a fig tree having leaves. Now, I'm going to tell you something about a fig tree. He went to see it, perhaps he would find something on it. See, with a fig tree, this is a few days before his crucifixion, which is the Passover, which is end March, early April, our calendar system. And it's spring in the Northern Hemisphere. Follow me on this? That is when these trees are in leaves. If you want to really have a good harvest of figs, you have to come back in August. So this is not really the season for the figs. But you would expect to find little ones, young ones. And they wouldn't be as tasty, but they were very nourishing. And that is what he was looking for. He wasn't fussy. He'd eat the little ones, the beginnings. So, let's pick up the story. When he came to it, he found nothing but what? Only leaves. Only leaves. Nothing to eat. For it was not really, of course, I told you, it's August, the season for figs. Now in response, he said this to it. Let no one eat fruit from you ever again. That seems very harsh to the fig tree. Yeah, there were no fruits in it, but hey, after all, it wasn't the season. Right? There should have been some, at least. But they weren't. Well, that's a bit rude to curse it. That it'll be of no use anymore. Now, you're following the story so far. Remember the other fig tree, the one that was not fruitful? Because we'll bring them together in a minute. Yes. His disciples heard it. And you know that the fig tree here, still, even though it's not a parable, but it is a parable in action, the fig tree still represents Israel here. To understand what he did is Israel. He's come to the end of his ministry. Israel has no fruit. give it an extension of time. This is the question. And this is what is really acted out here by Jesus. We'll come back to this. So he goes into the temple, and he has a look around in the temple. And what does he see?
Ah, yes.
It's like Paddy's Market. You could be forgiven, you're in Paddy's Market. So they came to Jerusalem, then Jesus went into the temple, began to drive out all those who brought and sold in the temple, and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And of course all the doves got free, the place was full of doves and money. Because they had a temple currency, you had to buy the animals of sacrifice. This is the temple currency. The exchange from your money to the temple currency was a rip-off. By the time you sold bought the animal, you probably pay about between 4 to 10 times the money that you could buy it in your local village for. It was an absolute rip-off, and the Sadducees were really the ones that were in financial control here. And even the Pharisees would have had a kickback off that one. It was a shocking affair. And this is what happens. He threw his authority. And you know what? They took notice of him. And he would not allow anyone to carry wares through the temple. He wouldn't allow that. Then he taught, saying to them, "Is it not written, my house?" Here is the first problem. They think it was their house. No, it's not. The church is not your church, the church is his church. The temple was not their temple, it was the temple of him. The rightful owner of the temple stood in the temple and just threw him out. Now this is right at the end of the ministry. But now here's something interesting. He did exactly that 3.5 years earlier when he started his ministry. Did you know that? There were 2 times when Jesus cleansed the temple. This is vital you understand that. A similar thing happened. He threw them all out and started to minister to the people. Now at the end of his ministry, he's doing the same thing. He's cleansing the temple. Well, the temple really personified him. There was nothing wrong with the temple. It was a misuse of the temple. And they made a misuse of their temple. They really made a misuse of him by refusing to accept him. That is what happened. A question. A house of prayer for all nations. You see, this is the problem. Not only had they considered the temple to be theirs, but they had refused to share with other nations who should have been there coming to pray to God. They hadn't shared the gospel. They had a Jonah attitude. I don't want to go to Nineveh. Full of Assyrians, don't like them. They're not us. They're not one of us. What a terrible, heartless attitude. But that's what they suffered from. But you have made it a den of thieves. God entrusted. This is not just about ripping their own people off. This is about having the gospel truth and withholding it from the other nation. That is thievery. When you don't share what you know about Jesus and you are unwilling to share, it is theft to those to whom you're not willing to explain it. Get the picture? Now, question. Did they continue afterwards with the trading and everything else? What do you think?
Yes.
3 years, 3.5 years earlier he cleansed it. What were they doing? Exactly the same thing. They had returned to their practice from before. That's what they did. Oh no, they returned to that. They didn't listen. It was a correction of a temple use or misuse. Because if the temple use is corrupt, or the understanding of the temple is corrupt, then the nation is corrupt. You can't have an unholy worship and a holy nation, can you? No. So if it happened incorrectly at the temple, then clearly the whole nation was rotten and corrupt. And that's what it was spiritually. His ministry was predicted to last for 3.5 years. We see from this story it actually did. Probation for the Jewish nation ends 3.5 years later. So no longer the chosen people, but individuals still can be saved. The Jews continue to live on borrowed times individually. Forget about them as a nation, they're calling they failed. But they could have still saved themselves individually if they accepted. And of course, after Pentecost, you end up as in a matter of a few months, you end up as a church of some 20,000 people. 20,000 at least. All meeting houses, places. Wonderful, wonderful. It just exploded. Why? Because he was risen and they'd seen him. Paul says in the Corinthians, he said, he makes this statement, this observation to the Jews, for the benefit of the Jews. He said, 500 of them saw him a few years later, and many of them are still alive today. You don't believe me? Go and ask them. Well, that's true. And so, this is, the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. Why was the temple destroyed in 70 AD, or any year you like to pick? Why was the temple destroyed? What was God's hand in this? Jesus personified the temple. They had crucified the temple, and God took the literal temple off them. They rejected him, never to be rebuilt, never a temple to rebuild. So, can a Jew be saved? Of course they can be saved, just like you and me. There's no difference. But they're no longer the chosen nation, and they rejected it. And they will never have a temple on the Temple Mount. You'll have World War III, it's the whole body of Islam. Because that's where the third most holy site of Islam is. It'll never happen. The cursed fig tree. Let's have a look back to the tree. Remember it? Jesus pronounced a curse on it. I want you to see this. Now in the morning, this is Wednesday. In the morning, as they pass by, they're coming back to the temple. They saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. Now that's a miracle. The tree, they can be 20 feet high or higher. 30 feet, they can be massive, fig trees can really be huge, particularly very wide as well. I don't know how big it was, but it was dried up from the roots, which means it's never going to perform. Now who did the fig tree actually typify? What had Israel shown? Did they have fruits, yes or no?
No.
There you have it. It was right about them, wasn't he? And so Peter remembered what Jesus said the day before. He said to him, Rabbi, look, the fig tree you cursed, he said, it is withered away. It is completely gone. Do you know what? This was really the first, the only miracle of destruction that Jesus ever performed. All the other miracles were about healing, about seeing, about walking, about what anybody else couldn't do. Cures, leprosy, bleedings. He could do that. This is the only miracle that I'm aware of that he did do that destroyed it. It's quite interesting. That means, did he destroy Israel? No, he took away from Israel the benefits that they had received by his grace. They had an extension. But they didn't take up the extension. Do you understand? They forfeited the right of the extension and lost. If Israel, I have a question for you. If Israel had been given more time, let's talk about this for a minute. Suppose that the ministry of Jesus, instead of 3.5 years, would have been 10 years. Make it 30 years. Would it have made any difference? Would they have been believed on him? No, it would have gotten worse. I think that may be close to the truth. It's interesting. And so, Israel had religious leaves. They were religious, but they had no fruit. You can be a tree yourself. It's an individual tree, so it applies to us individually. You can be a Christian. You can have all the leaves you like, religious leaves. But if it doesn't bear fruit, if it's not finding expression, what do you expect? How much time do you, that Jesus, that God should give you, extend to you on borrowed time? Be an interesting question for you to write down. Be a very interesting question. Book of Isaiah. 750, 730 years before, God expressed to the prophet his frustration with Israel. What more could I have done for my vineyard? Vineyard is Israel. That I have not done in it. You know, he was going to dig around it. He was going to fertilize that unfruitful fig tree. He had done that before. But he still wanted to continue. When I expected to bring forth grapes, this is now the other allegory, of course, is a grapevine. Bring forth good grapes, not bad ones, but I get wild grapes. God is working on us through his Spirit. It's available. It's all there. We have the written word. We have each other, by the way. That's why you're meant to come to church, because you are a people who are to encourage each other on your spiritual journey. And now please tell me, let me tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will take away the hedge. Hedge is protection. And it shall be burned. I will break down the wall, so it's all open to be trampled underfoot. I will lay it waste. It will not be pruned or dug, but there shall come up briars and thorns. Now thistles and thorns are synonymous with sins. So he takes away the protection, all hell breaks loose, so to speak. You're handed over. The worst thing that could happen to us is if you lose his protection. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain on it. That is a withdrawal of the Holy Spirit, the early and the latter rain. Book of Isaiah explains that. You don't have the Holy Spirit, you don't have a hope. You may even do well financially, in your business, in whatever. But if the Spirit withdraws from you, you are lost. Because you can't reach the golden gates without it. It's a fact.
And that's what happens at end times, isn't it?
Yep. So Jesus answered and said to them, this is his answer. What is the answer to the fairness of unfairness? Have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you that whoever says to this mountain, have a look at this, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever it takes. So don't try it at home. What's he saying? Well, we have mountains in our highways, as the song goes. So that's a joke proper, that's fine. Life feels like climbing mountains sometimes. Would that be right?
Yes.
Well, he says he can move it. But it has to be done by faith. When you have faith in God, it means you know him. If you have faith in a God that is not the true God, your faith won't help you, it's wasted. That's another thing. It's not your faith. Faith that comes from him enables you. So my faith, don't mix it with conviction or conclusion of my rationale and thinking and what I consider to be correct or just or applicable. No. The faith that we need is the faith that comes from him. You cannot produce that. Never. But with that faith, you can move mountains. It's a figure of speech, of course. Yeah? You're not going to move mountains. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, there it is, believe the power of prayer, that you receive them and you shall have them. Yeah. For the wages of sin is death, the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We know that. We all accept that. It happens to be true. The grace that saves me is also the grace that sanctifies me. The extension of time is grace. You're in it, you got to use it, redeem your time, and He will do the rest. God's grace period of time. Genesis 3, my spirit shall not strive his men forever, for indeed he is flesh, that means sinful. Yet his days shall be 120 years. Isn't it amazing? The story of Noah. People were given a time frame. You're not giving a time frame. I'm not giving a time frame. But the people in Noah's days had a time frame. Noah could stand there and preach and say, you got 120 years, then God is going to cause a great flood to kill you all. And you can imagine the people standing there listening. Did they believe it? No, because there were only 8 people in the ark, and that was a close family, you see. They left behind, if the girls that married the 3 sons of Noah, the parents, the brothers, the sisters, the cousins, the nieces, the nephews, friends, neighbors, they were all left behind. Do you get the picture of Noah's flood? How many people were killed at Noah's flood? The Bible doesn't give a number, but I can tell you it might as well have been millions. You can almost compute the potential population under the conditions that were prevailing, the high ages, the absence of diseases. We're talking most likely millions of people. Can God do that? Yes, He can. Will He do it? Ultimately, you see things much bigger than that. You don't know what's waiting for us. You should know. One day God's going to destroy all the wicked. You say, good God can't do that. Yes, He can. Because He's good. He has to eliminate sin from the universe. And if you cling to your sin, you're not using your grace time, your extension of time. Well, you're going to be on the wrong side. It's not a cry putting away. Forget your hellfire, somewhere you can't go. This is all fallacy. That there will be an absolute destruction that you can view from a city called the New Jerusalem. The 2 o'clock one, we do Revelation, the end of Revelation spells it out. Anyway, the patience of God for 120 years that makes no impact on these people kept waiting until the days of Noah. Why? Here is the reason. Oops, I missed the reason. Kept waiting in the days of Noah, and one line doesn't. And that's because he wanted to save them. That line didn't come up, I'm sorry. 2 Peter. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise. It's saying the same thing in a different way. As some would count slackness. People think, oh, well, God is not doing anything. Yes, he is. He's waiting. He's long-suffering. Not feeling that how many should perish. Every person counts for God, that all should come to repentance. The foreknowledge of God has it that the majority won't. But nobody of that majority could ever say, I never had the opportunity. You did. You have, right here this afternoon, if you haven't already, you can make that decision. Make that surrender. It's there for you. And he is waiting for that. Wars. Question. So many terrible wars. Why does God allow all this killing, all those terrible wars? I'll give you one very good reason. To begin with, he never started any of them. Will that do? That's a start. But here is the problem. We got to talk about this. Have a look at this guy. You remember that? 2011? One of the most horrible, horrible, horrible things. He is a right-wing nationalist, who committed such horrendous murder. He had a bomb in a van and that killed 8 people. And then he went to an island where he knew there was a camp meeting, Christian camp meeting of teenagers, youngsters. And he went there and he shot 69 of them. And the people that are related to them, the parents, the friends, they're still grieving immensely. And maybe his parents are grieving too for what he did. I don't know. He's unrepentant as far as I know. He certainly was when he was in court and they put him away for life. It happened in Norway. Terrible, terrible. Here's some of the pictures of the kids that got killed. That's shocking. That's terrible. Why does God allow that? Why couldn't he have done something?
Yeah,
why? Here's the answer. And I'm just going to briefly explain it and that will be pretty it. Love, what is God? If you had to give God one description.
God is love.
God is love. Okay, let's agree on that. God is love. So what is God looking for in his creators, his creatures? Well, the angels, other beings from other worlds, or you and me. What's he looking for?
Love.
Is love voluntary or is it programmed? Can it be programmed? No. Because then it's not love, is it? So it has to be voluntary. Now, if you give someone the choice, they could go the other way before whatever consideration. Is that true? So if you won't end up with true love, you have the gift, the facility, that there can be a free moral choice. Is that true? So you are given the free moral choice, and it's up to you whether it is an expression of love, hatred, selfishness, greed, whatever. This man decided to express hatred. He didn't have to do it, but he did. God allowed it because love cannot exist without the freedom of choice. That's the reason. That's why Jesus said to them, repent or perish. Because if you repent, you become his, he comes in you, and you become love by choice. Yeah? That's what it's about. So all of us are living in borrowed time, which we don't deserve. Many people don't get it, by the way. These young kids didn't get it. I don't know why, I can't tell you. But I trust God's grace period of time, and I know I've got to make the most of it. And the words of Jesus must ring in our ears as we walk away from this place. That unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. No exception here. Not me, not you. Please make the most of this time. May God bless you.
Does Jesus care? When my heart is pained too deeply for mirth or song, as the burdens press and the cares distress, and the way grows weary and long. Does Jesus care? chains? Does he care enough to be
house beaming through the universe. Love. True, undefiled, pure love. That we look at each other and love each other. No selfishness, no usury, no bad thoughts, no resentments, no dislikes, just love. And that's why we go through all of this. And that's why bad things happen to good people, or even good things happen to bad people. But we do want that repentance in our life, and you need to help us, because we cannot do that by ourselves. We need to have faith in you, and we have to ask you for that faith, because we cannot produce that. But help us to do everything that we know we should be doing, that we come to that point. Really would love to see you and live. Lord, thank you for being here in our presence, the honor, everything that you have granted us. Thank you for the people here. Bless each and every one. Oh, that all might be saved. That'd be so wonderful. Lord, bless the friendship, the fellowship that we'll have as we have the food, and that the food may nourish our bodies. And I thank you for those who are always willing to produce this. And Lord, bless our fellowship, and bless us the coming week. Keep us strong. Keep us near to you. Please keep us strong. We need that strength from above. So bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen.